now we're an independent cooperative organisation in our own right, and actually a membership-based cooperative in our own right. I think we hit 150 members by the end of last week, and maybe it's gone up a bit more. So for those of you who are not members, you're very welcome. Please join us and see what a difference it can make to your life. You will feel much better about yourselves. But more seriously, we've embarked on something quite significant, we think, in education. And as Tony Webster was saying at the end of the panel discussion earlier on, we've probably hit a moment in British history, perhaps even global history, where something that's been around for the past 20 or 30 years in terms of neoliberal economics is now beginning to fade and is under serious challenge. And that might provide an opening, really, to get some humanistic economics and approaches to education and the way we live back centre stage again. So the college is pledged really to be at the centre of any moves in that direction, both nationally and also globally, because we remain part of a set of cooperative organisations across the entire world. And as we discovered from recent International Cooperative Alliance Congress that Simon Parkinson, our relatively new chief executive and principal, attended, the reputation of the college internationally is still very high. And David Rogers has strong connections with the ICA and so on, I think has testified to that in other circumstances. It's good to see you, David. David also used to be on a previous Cooperative College board. So nice to see you. I'm going to really merge the chair's welcome on the agenda with the chair's report, which has been circulated as a short one-page item. I didn't really want to go into that in great detail. In fact, the formal part of this AGM, up to, I guess, really the announcement of the elections, is probably doesn't need to be too lengthy. In part, we're putting to bed a piece of our very early history and a legacy of how we've transitioned from the Co-operative College in its old form to its new form. But the really interesting part of the meeting in many respects will be the final item, where Simon and Emma and perhaps other colleagues are going to talk about where we've reached in terms of visioning the future of the college and where we're going. Because there are going to be some very different things about that, but firmly embedded in cooperative values and in cooperative relationships. So I'll say a little bit more about that later on. But what I've tried to summarise in the printed version of the chair's report is really the experience of the interim board of trustees who were chosen through Cooperatives UK to really just get us through a transition that was really characterised by lots of legalities that needed to be changed in terms of our rules and constitution, some financial arrangements had to be put to bed, but chiefly the setting up of the college on the basis of a new membership. So we've had to invent the way we do membership, and we'll keep that under review so we can get it even more right in the future. We've had to rethink really the college's future strategy, given changes in the cooperative movement in Britain, but also other opportunities nationally and internationally that may open up for us. And we've done that really on the, and a lot of that will come up later through Simon and Emma's presentation, but we've done that really by also not leaving behind the legacy that we've inherited from the previous college boards. I'm delighted that Paul Summerfield, who was the last chair of the college in its old form, has also been able to join us today. Because we inherited from the previous arrangements with Co-operatives UK and Paul and other colleagues on that board, which I was also vice chair, a strong balance sheet. We'll perhaps talk a bit about that sort of later on at the presentation at the end. pretty good reputation in lots of ways. Some new avenues, particularly around cooperative schools, but there's been a big focus on that today, a whole new cooperative movement, potentially, and to some extent, actually, in Britain. And some really exciting and innovative international work in Africa and in Sri Lanka, where Scylla and other colleagues, Sarah and so on, have been doing some fascinating work in the post-conflict situation of the long civil war in Sri Lanka and how cooperatives can perhaps mend people's lives again and bring those communities back to communities that were devastated by the war back together so people can earn a decent living and have a tolerable level of life after some pretty awful years. And we've opened up new relationships as well internationally in Malaysia, South Korea, many other places, as well as keeping in touch with close colleagues in Canada. And, well, you could go through the whole world, really, and discover that we've got friends everywhere, and we want to build on those friendships and play our role in the future of the globe. So really just try to sum that up in the chair's report. And that's probably really all I wanted to say on that, except to give a few notes of thanks. One clearly to Simon, Emma, Scylla, their colleagues in the staff team of the college, who've been through, I think, fair to say, a period of some uncertainty, particularly given changes in the cooperative group, about the future of the college. And I think over the past few months, the working style internally in the college and the way in which colleagues from all parts of the staff team have collaborated together to help shape the future strategic planning for the college has been, I think, probably been worthy of a case study, really, in terms of how an old organisation reinvents itself as a new organisation. So thanks very much for them for bearing with us through all of that. They've also helped us keep a promise I vainly made to a cooperative congress 2 years ago when Ed Mayo invited everybody in the room to say what they were going to do to move cooperation forward in the year ahead. And I got up and said, we're going to invent a new cooperative. Well, thank you for helping us fulfil on that pledge, because that's what we're well on our way to doing. And Cooperatives UK, in fact, been terrific over that whole period in terms of easing the independence of the college, and also agreeing to keep in touch with us, both through, I think, regular meetings that Simon has with Ed and other. There's a Holyoke House. Group, isn't there?
Yeah, it's really nice. We meet once a month and all
talk
to each other.
So it helps cement some collaboration, I think, between us, Co-ops UK, Co-op Press, perhaps, and other inhabitants of this weird and wonderful building that we have up, George Taylor Colonial, who was himself weird and wonderful in his own ways. The other way in which Co-ops UK keep in touch with us is they have a place on our board. And though John Chilcott, who's been has taken up that place over the past few months, can't be here today, delighted to say that Co-ops UK have reappointed him for the coming term of office that he would have. So that relationship, I think, is in very healthy condition now. So that's absolutely excellent. The other thanks I really wanted to give was again really to Paul Summerfield and previous members of the College Board for leaving us in the condition in which we that gave us a firm foundation to move forward in many ways. But I'd just like to thank the other interim trustees who took on a job that I think for some of them was somewhat more demanding and higher in its expectations than perhaps they had envisaged. But we were all going into new territory, as we are at this meeting, in terms of not quite knowing what it was we were encountering. But John Chilcott, I mentioned, who's also played a role in helping us with employment and remuneration policies. I'd like to thank Tricia Jaff, who's here today, acted as the vice chair of the College Board and brought terrific experience from her own background as a head teacher and through involving the co-operative schools generally. So thanks, Tricia, for all that you've done there. Twin professors, Basil Johnson from Open University and Tony Webster from Northumbria University, who've been real tower of strength. The board meetings have been really quite interesting. Was there a combination of people who have primarily, this might be a bit unfair and caricature, but here we are. So we've got members who have very academic and educational background, and members who have a very cooperative commercial background, and the dynamics between that, because they've not been tensions or frictions, but they've been really collaborative in terms of welding together something that has a coherence to it, as you'll we'll see later on, really, when we come to the presentation. Hazel and Tony have also kept us on track in keeping our understanding of quality standards and quality assurance in the forefront of our minds. So it's important that we maintain and develop a reputation for quality in everything that we do, in every area of the college's work. So that really is good. Craig Lumsden, who I think I saw earlier on from the phone co-op, it's also been terrific, certainly in his advice on marketing and on business offers, drawing on the experience of the phone co-op and other experiences Craig has had. That's been really helpful, so thanks for that Craig as well. Pamela Maxwell, who's up there somewhere, at the back. Hi, Pamela. Pam was sort of inherited from the previous board in that we felt we needed, or the board, interim board actually wanted, someone who could have had a link with college learners. And that was a role that Pam was performing on the former college board. And she kindly agreed to, in effect, be slotted into the new board as well. And so Pam has made some very useful and skillful insights into the meetings of the board. So thanks, Pam. Despite having some nightmare journeys, I think, from out of Glasgow to get to our meetings sometimes. Similarly, we wanted to ensure that staff representation on the board was kept up. And Steve Kingman, the technological whiz, kindly stepped into that role as well. That, again, has been a real tower of strength for the board in understanding how we build a relationship between trustees and members of staff. And so thanks, Steve, for really putting all that that effort into that work as well. And somebody else who couldn't make it today, Roger Middleton, again, has a terrific background in cooperative accounting and finance, acted as chair of our audit and risk committee to keep an eye on the financial aspects of our business plans. Again, Roger just has a huge depth of rich experience. He had decided not to stand for the board. He's meant to be retired, and for some unknown reason, he wants to be retired, so we had to let him go, really, rather than, I'm sure we'll keep in touch with him. So I hope I've not missed anybody. I don't think I have there. But they've been a terrific group of people to work with in an unusual situation. We've been a kind of collective midwife for something, and hopefully the baby has now been born and is about to take its first steps as a properly constituted cooperative with its first members' annual meeting. Sorry if I've gone on rather at length there, but it was only 7 months or so, or a bit longer than that. That does lead in really to item four, which is the interim board's annual report and nil financial return to 30th of April of last year. That's been circulated to members. It's a bit of a necessary document in order to put a number of matters to bear with the Charity Commission trustees. Charity Commission, because we are a charity. So it does summarise the piece of work that went on up until April of that year. The accounts that are referred to there are filed with the Charity Commission, so they've gone in and scrutinised. We haven't produced accounts for this meeting because we don't really have accounts for this part of the college's year. But Emma will give a bit of a profile, I suppose, really, of the college's financial position, which is quite robust as a balance sheet, but we've clearly got to do some work in terms of how we earn our daily living. But the strategic plan that Simon will talk about will chart the directions that the board and the staff have been shaping so far. I think really this is presented for information, really. But I ought to ask if there are any questions on this. And if not, perhaps we just note that for information and put that into the history books. Brings us then to items 5 and 6, which are two proposals. One of which, proposal number one, that I've put to the meeting for approval, is from the Board of Trustees to confirm the appointment of our auditors, KPMG, for an extended financial year that we have as a result of the transition that ends on the 31st of July 2016. We will review who we have as auditors. I get that in quickly because cooperative meetings people rightly ask about the credibility of the major auditors, so we've not lost sight of that point. But it'll just help us sort of put our next set of accounts to bear properly. Just seek the meeting's approval for that. Everyone's got voting cards. Just show them. People, there's a bit of an online vote as well.
Yeah, that's the passes. Show how the meeting consistent with the
votes. Well, it's clearly being carried. But sorry, was there a query?
No. I don't hear.
Have you got online? Are you a member of the college?
No.
Are you a member?
No, you would have to be. I'm sorry. You would have to be a member of the college to have a
post.
And some people have already voted postally as well. So it's just the people that need it to vote. Thank you.
Yes. Please join. Yes. Sorry. Pioneer international measure would be absolutely wonderful. But. Okay, thanks, we approve that. second proposal from the Board of Interim Trustees is a constitutional amendment, which will, well, it goes on for pages. Would enable us at future elections to offer online voting, which we weren't able to do this time. We're learning as we're going along, but that, in our view, would be very helpful to a lot of members if we could do it in that way. So let's see those in favour of that constitutional amendment. And the.
Can I ask if anybody wants to vote against?
Which one do you like to vote against? Nobody wants to vote against the. Okay, so we carried those. So we go over the page onto item 7, which brings us to the results of our first election for the Board of Trustees. We're electing 4 board members. I'd ought to say that in our constitution, the board can also co-opt at least 2 further people if it feels it's important to do that. So there's an item there for, I guess, the first formal meeting of the new board. And perhaps at this stage, what I need to do is introduce Elliot Roberts from the Electoral Reform Services to just take us through.
As been said, there are 4 places available. Everybody who was eligible was both emailed and posted out a form to submit their vote. 4 successful candidates in alphabetical order: John Boyle, Tricia Jaffe, apologies. Hazel Johnson and Nigel Todd. The successful candidates need to do now for about 30, 40 seconds is just come up and give a summary of what they propose to do over the next 12 months. So in alphabetical order, that will be John Boyle. Is John here?
Some may or may not be prepared.
I wrote something thin, gosh, that's me if I get elected. Thank you very much, by the way, everybody, for voting for me. I'm going to start by saying I am not an academic, I'm not a researcher, I think I might be called a practitioner. I'm a membership officer, I have been a membership officer both of a retail co-op and a co-op party for a long time. And what I hope to do for and with the this wonderful new society, can I say society? Is to help in that membership area to drive its profile, to support staff, colleagues, particularly in events, and in also reaching into the other areas of cooperation. We've been very traditionally in the retail sector, and partly because I am also chair of Revolver Cooperative, I am on half a dozen cooperatives, if you've forgotten how many, but I will try to bring that experience and those connections, as well as a bit of mad enthusiasm to the goal. So thank you very much for electing me. Thank you.
It's Trisha Jaffe. I wanted to start off actually by paying tribute and great thanks to the CIO, the interim board. It's really been an honour and a pleasure to be part of it with a very heavy workload, including the appointment of the president of the CEO and president CEO and principal in amongst setting up this new organisation. But actually, it's been fascinating because every single person has brought something different to the table that has been challenging, thoughtful, reflective, and we've ended up with a good approach to going forward. I'm also extremely grateful to you for electing me to the first board of the new college. I have very much enjoyed the work alongside the people who are employed by the college, particularly given my experience in the school sector, which, as has been said a number of times today, 850 plus schools. If you put together how many adults that is who work within those sorts of cooperatives, and then the number of young people who are our cooperators of the future, who we could be engaging in that, there is a lot of work to do and a lot of learning to be offered to schools that we're hoping we're going to be able to be part of, and I shall be working, or continuing to work, with the college on the school improvement framework that we've been engaged on developing so far. So thank you, and I look forward to the next year.
Well, I too was an interim trustee, and I thank everybody who has had confidence to vote me back in again. As Tricia said, it has been the most extraordinary experience of helping the college to move forward. And I must say that our last trustees meeting was quite something when Simon presented the strategy for the college and for its future, and we were so impressed and about all the work that's been done by the staff, and I hope we've given them the support that they've needed over the past year and 18 months. I'm as you know from the little blurbs, I work at the Open University, and I've worked there for a long time, and so I have quite a long background in adult education and in distance learning. I guess that goes without saying. But I also have both helped to support but also benefited from the Co-operative College in the research that I and others at the Open University have done. And the Co-operative College is just such an extraordinary hub in a way of networks and contacts and knowledge, and it's really a tremendous resource. And so I think as part of my future commitment to the college is to help it continue and build those resources. My field is also international development, and that is part of what the college does as well. And so certainly part of what I hope to do with the college is to help support its work in international development, both practically and programmatically, and also in research. You know, the future for the college, I think, is bright, and it's really kind of turned a corner in all sorts of ways. And so I'm absolutely thrilled to be back on there as a trustee. Thank you very much.
Really work with the staff team and the board and now with the membership to really take us forward into I think quite an exciting period of cooperative education. There are so many things that we can do and so many ways in which we can raise our profile, I think, and certainly developing the membership base of the college is one of the ways in which we do that, by networking with all sorts of other organisations and institutions within and beyond the cooperative movement, but also internationally, but also encouraging more people who are interested in education to become part of the college through becoming members, because we're one of the, this terrible neoliberal period Tony described earlier on that we've been through. There have been fewer and fewer spaces for people to talk about and do something about education as many of us understand it, rather than being simply an instrument of the state or looking at education simply as training people to be cogs in a wheel and not think so much about what they're doing and not have any power over what happens to them. So I think through cooperatives and cooperative education we can meet that need. The other thing I'd be particularly interested in is the fact that we are due to have the college's centenary in 2019. And that provides, in a way, a period of time that enables us to focus on our strategy, but also a period of time to build up to something that will be quite significant in the history of British adult education as well. And there are lots of ways I think we can work with others and display our own resources that can really make a significant event of 2019. So I'm grateful to that, and thank you to everyone who voted for me. Sometimes my experience of cooperative elections has been probably like a throw of a dice, really, because I've been on and off committees in the co-op group as a result of that. But I feel with something like Co-operative College membership, we have something that could be a real community of interest in all sorts of ways, and that could only strengthen and develop the kind of democracy that we want to create. So, thanks very much. And also to say, I've mentioned John Chilcott is continuing as a trustee from Co-operatives UK. For some unaccountable reason, Steve Kingman felt he had enough of being on the board. He has lots of other things to do, really, in the college. But Sophie Stewart, who we won't embarrass by asking her to say anything if she's here. But is Sophie? But Sophie has just joined us as a staff representative. So you're very welcome, Sophie. I know you've sat through one of these. Not said you don't want to come back. And we're also aware that there are a couple of membership categories we just need to do a bit more work on to bring into effect. So one of those is the seat that's allocated to represent students, learners at the Co-operative College, so we're getting on with that. And the other one is the membership category for organisations. And so that again will be the task for the new board, just to shape that and get that rolled out so that we can complete the overall composition of the board as quickly as we can. I'd like to just word of acknowledgement and thanks to candidates who were not successful in the elections, including former trustees. But the fact is, we had an election, didn't we? And I mean, it's a terrific tribute to all the people who put themselves forward that they wanted to be part of this. Remember, well, I didn't last very long, but my first job after leaving university was to work for the Co-operative College or Co-operative Union at Stanford Hall, this huge stately home that we had in Loughborough. And one of my first jobs was to complete a piece of work that my predecessor as a Member Education Development Officer had been dealing with. And that was to collate the results of a survey into what was called lay leadership around cooperative societies. And what we discovered really was that right around the cooperative societies, except in some but very few societies, there were hardly any contested elections. In fact, societies, particularly smaller ones, were struggling to fill their boards. And so we then took that to the Cooperative Education Convention, which, for those who remember those wonderful Easters at windy seaside resorts, was something we inflicted on ourselves, but often had quite interesting discussions. But on this occasion, we presented the report into lay leadership and the results of the survey, and the then Education Executive, which is a cooperative committee, was on the platform sort of looking down on us. And the Cooperative News helpfully had a picture of them over a report of the debate and the discussion on the report, but had the headline above the picture, a picture of inactivity. Quite got to the bottom of that, the reasoning behind that. So thank you, though, everyone who stood for making it a proper election, getting us off to a proper start in all of that. We're not, we promise or threaten you that we're not going to leave you alone. Expect to hear from us one way or another shortly. I think that probably brings us to the end, really, of the of the elections and meet the trustees section. On item 9, we've invited members to submit questions in advance to the college management team and trustees, just in case we had to research the answers. I don't think we had any questions, did we? But there will be a chance for questions under the presentation, which, firstly, in thanking you for being with us in this first historic AGM of the college, I'd also like to hand over to Simon and to Emma to take us through the presentation.
Wired. Yeah. Yeah, it looks like the budget wouldn't stretch to two lapel mics. So we'll make it with one. So. Excellent. We're still okay volume wise? Can people hear me? Mm-hmm. Yep, excellent. So I'm Simon Parkinson, I'm the Chief Exec and Principal of the Co-operative College, but actually I'm just standing here as one representative of the team today. This has been a real team effort over the last 12 months, including the Transitional Board, and I'd like to add my thanks to that board as a first-time CEO coming in and working with such a challenging and supportive board, and the way they got that right was, you know, fantastic, and it was a privilege to work. And work with you guys, and I look forward to working with the new board, I think, as we all do. So thank you for that. Steve's going to drive the slides for us, and we're just going to give you a real overview of where we're trying to take the college over the next 3 years. You've got a printed document, I think, in front of you, and you've got a little bit of a collateral that we've put together, which people will try and tell you it's a coaster, it's not, it's a jigsaw. So it's just a little something to remember us by. And I'll try and keep it really at the top level, and we'll race through a little bit because I know we're short of time. So as a team and as a board, we've really worked to redefine the college's position and to actually acknowledge that, you know, in our mind, we absolutely know, and I know that everybody in this room knows, that great things happen when people cooperate. We all know that, that's why we're part of this international movement. And actually, we know that we've got a role to play, a really big role to play at the college, both in the UK and internationally. So we set ourselves a really ambitious long-term aim and some really wide-ranging strategic outcomes. But actually, we're up for that challenge. We are up for the challenge as a team, and we think we've got a well-thought-through plan and strategy that will take us through the next 3 years, will get us closer to these strategic outcomes, and put us in a position by 2019, when we'll be celebrating our centenary, as Nigel said, to really carry on and be at the forefront of cooperative education across the movement. The way we've done that is to really try and work through the building blocks that we think need to be put in place. And I've left this slide in. This is a presentation that we've run with the board, a version of that, and that we've run with the full team. So now we're running it with our members, our initial members and friends and stakeholders. The point of this slide, you will see that what we've been doing is really working as a team. So whilst my name's on there as a lead for organisational design, culture, teamwork, I guess that is my role as CEO, I can't deliver this without the rest of the leadership team and the business support function beyond that. So I'm really, really quickly going to just embarrass everybody by just asking them to just make themselves known. Nigel's already embarrassed Steve, but Steve's leading for us on membership and events, so Steve will be a key contact for our members going forward. We'll talk about how we're going to strengthen the resource in that area. So Steve, just everyone can see you. Yeah. Angela's leading for us on our core learning offer and our delivery mechanisms for people that don't know Angela. Julie Thorpe's leading for us on our schools work. She's hiding down at the front here. I won't make her stand up. I will make her stand up. Well, can I ask her to stand up? Yes, there you go.
I'm standing up.
For those that don't know Scylla, you know, Scylla's our VP of leading on our research, which is a vital part of what we do. We've got Sarah, who has traditionally led on our international work, but we recognise that if we are truly international, then our projects span both the UK and international, and Sarah's leading on all of those for us. We've got Gillian, who leads on heritage and is part of the Co-operative Heritage Trust with us as well. And then a big role for Emma that she'll talk to you about a little bit in some of the back office enablers and some of the work that we need to do internally to really drive the strategy forward. And then the main man right at the bottom of it, the Captain Greg, the guy that keeps us level as a team, who actually holds this together for us and helps run our program management and reporting office so that we know that we're on track. So a really, really, you know, strong team effort, and we'll talk about the importance of the rest of the colleagues at the college as well as we go forward. So what I'm going to go through now are just our top level commitments. They're in the strategic document that you've got in front of you. By their nature, when you try and put them into single bullet points, you minimise the amount of time and effort and work and thinking that is behind this. There are really large operational plans behind each of these bullet points that says how we're going to do it, whose accountability it is, who's driving on it, what our measures of success will be. But we just wanted to share with you our top commitments so that you as our members will have something to judge our progress against over the next 3 years. What you'll see in each one of these is this is a growth strategy. This isn't a strategy that says we're standing still. This isn't a strategy that says we're in any way retreating from work that we've done previously. We know what we're good at the college. We know what we need to get better at, and we're determined to do it. And to its great credit, the board have taken the decision to allow us the investment funds to do that as well. Emma will talk a little bit about that, but this is a real growth strategy. We want you as our members to help shape it. So that absolute first and right commitment about recruiting new members, but not only numbers, it's about having engaged members and supporting our members in a two-way conversation so that they can help shape the future direction of the college. And as Nigel alluded to, at the moment we've concentrated on our individual members. That was important to get us to this first historic point of the inaugural AGM so that we could have the contested election, so that we could put that governance piece in place. But we've got huge ambitions for an organisational membership offer as well that will see us connect with a range of organisations, both the traditional cooperative organisations, but actually slightly further afield. Rory's been talking today about the social and solidarity economy. Why wouldn't we want to tap into organisations that share the same values? Maybe they're not pure co-ops, but actually they're in our space and we want to work with them and we want to change the world with them. We've also then got a commitment on events that Steve's leading to us. This now will become an annual conference for us. We'll look and we'll review after tomorrow about how we can make it better, how we can improve, but this will be our showcase event going forward. It will be our member engagement event. It works well for us to have our members meeting as the centrepiece of a conference. Will it look exactly the same next year? I don't know yet, but we'll start to work through what we mean by that, but our commitment to having that annual conference. As again Nigel alluded to, we've got a big run in now to the centenary year, and we've got some really good thinking gone into a full calendar of centenary events that we can put together. And we also are privileged at the college and really do enjoy welcoming a whole range of international visitors. Not only is it great for us as a college that people want to come to the college, want to come to the northwest of England, want to go to Rochdale as the birthplace of cooperation, so we learn from them as much as they learn from us. But actually people, it is a real business opportunity for us as well. People want to come and they want to come on study visits and they want us to host them and put great content out there for them. So it's a big part of the strategy going forward that we will continue and grow the number of international visitors that we welcome to the UK and to the Northwest in particular. And in terms of our schools work, there's been a lot of focus on schools today, rightly so, and there'll be more focus again tomorrow. It's an important part of what we do. There is a huge and growing network of 850 cooperative schools. Our first recognition is that we need to do more as a college to build those existing relationships. So we've got relationships with a good number of those schools, but we want to strengthen those. So there's a big job for Julie and sort of extra resource that we'll put into this area. We are going to launch quite quickly a school improvement programme, and that's a cooperative school improvement programme. And there'll be more information on that coming out. We'll probably trail a little bit about tomorrow and then in the coming weeks and months. We've heard from schools, and we heard it again today, that they need support in really understanding how we do member engagement in an education setting. You know, it's different than a retail setting, it's different than a workers' co-op. How do we really make stakeholder and member engagement work for schools? So we're going to invest some time and energy in there. We've had great conversations with the National Governors Association and other bodies about how we can really put some great training programs together for trustees and governors, and those will be coming as well. And we will continue, and it'll be interesting to see in which flavour of conversion. You know, we have got a cooperative multi-academy trust model and standalone academy model. We have got trust schools, and we will see whether the number of trust schools that we can still convert in the existing political landscape. You know, really, really interesting, I think, to see how the narrative is already reining back from this sort of bold statement about all schools becoming academies. I think we might see a bit of movement in that over the next sort of year or 18 months. And we'll be at the forefront of helping schools understand that it's credible, an alternative to private sector academisation, which is, you know, built on cooperative values and principles. In terms of our learning, we've rightly got a strong reputation for learning and development. It is in many ways the core. It should be the engine room of what we do. And actually what we've really, really worked on, and Angela's absolutely the right person to lead this for us, is a complete re-evaluation, redesign and relaunch of our suite of training materials, and an absolute commitment to moving lots of those materials into a really high-tech online environment. We're on contract with a new technology provider. We will have learning and development products that are optimised for mobile. You know, right the way down, that's how people are accessing learning now. So we'll be doing that real blended learning. We still believe in that classroom-based learning, you know, but we absolutely want to make the move into online, and we're going to invest in that area as well. And then in terms of research, you know, again, core and the strong reputation that the college has got in this area, and we recognise that and we want to continue that. You know, with Dr. Scylla Ross in the team and leading on this for us, you know, we are committed to establishing and developing a new network of people who are interested in and connected with research and cooperative education. There's been the flyer in the delegate pack about that. We'll keep talking about that again tomorrow. We want to build on some of the existing work that we're doing in terms of an MA educational leadership that we've already launched with Manchester. We want to look at that both in the UK with some of our partners like Sheffield Hallam, but also internationally with growing connections that we've got with St Mary's University in Canada, with Newcastle University in Australia. We really think there's a space here where we could really sort of try and establish an international approach to cooperative administration. You know, so we're working strongly on that. And the final bit on that was we're committed to try and carry on securing the funding through the really tough and competitive bidding process that research funding is subject to. So we put a lot of effort into bidding for the funding, and we're going to, you know, really try and sharpen our focus and make sure that we're successfully bringing the funding that we need so that we can carry on doing great research. Again, this slide doesn't do justice to the amount of work that already goes on in this field that Sarah leads, and the appetite and the ambition that we've got in this field. We are well regarded and well recognised for delivering projects in so-called developing countries. Actually, we want to extend that out. We want to do more, and we want to do better, both in developing countries, and Nigel touched on some of our work in Sri Lanka, you know, post-conflict or even post-natural disaster, you know, in terms of the tsunami. You can look around the world, you can see other events, other areas of the world, and I know there's a fringe meeting tomorrow where actually the microspace is opening where cooperative solutions can help build a fairer society and a better world for people, and we want to again be at the forefront of that. Finally, on heritage, this is you know, a key part of the college's work again, but slightly different relationship. So there is an organisation called the Cooperative Heritage Trust. It's an organisation in and of its own right with its own board of trustees. The college is the current managing agent for the Cooperative Heritage Trust, so we jointly employ the team that work at the National Cooperative Archive and at the Rochdale Pioneers Museum. And actually, we value that. We think that the benefit that we get from being connected to the heritage work is huge for us as a college, and we hope that the connection back between the college and the heritage team helps their work as well. So we really want to re-establish that management agreement. There is a full strategy for the Cooperative Heritage Trust that's already been agreed through their board, and actually there's links to it, I think, in the document that you've got in front of it for anybody that wanted to look at that as well. So at this point, I'm going to hand over to Emma, who's going to use the roving mic, and I think the temptation to start doing karaoke is strong. So she's resisting. So Emma will just talk you through some of her areas of work, and then I'll come back and maybe just finalise it, take any questions and answers, and then, you know, we'll move on to the last bit.
So I am
going to
resist singing because I do love a bit of karaoke. So, as Simon and Nigel alluded to, the college has got a really strong balance sheet. I think we're circa 3.4 million at the moment. But the last few years hasn't been kind to us on the income and expenditure account. And we know we need to do this. So one of my commitments was being a financially sustainable, no reliance on investment gains by 2019. I've modelled this through and I think we can do it. But to do that, what we really need to do is to look at our fundraising and our bid writing. So at the moment we don't have a fundraising strategy, which is unusual for a charity. So we sometimes chase pots of money rather than being strategic about it. So now what we need to do with Scylla on research and with Sarah on projects and with the support of Greg is we're going to put that strategy into place so we can really focus on the areas that we want to develop and we can make strategic decisions about that. What's really important for us as well is infrastructure. So it's how we work together. It's making sure we've got investment in the systems because we're a very small staff team, but we need to make ourselves more streamlined so all of us can be entering information into different systems and it just doesn't make sense. So one of the commitments I've said is I want to try and get as many systems as I can integrated so we can be the best team we can be working together. And I also want to make sure that the working environment that we have actually represents the culture that we're trying to sustain at the college and is that vibrant place to work. People enjoy coming to work at the college. Visitors get the buzz when they walk through the front door of the college. It is different. It is exciting. And then one thing I'm now going to look to John to help me with You said it, John. You said you were going to help us with some marketing stuff, so I'm going to take you up on that. An effective and consistent approach to marketing and communications. You're regretting it now, aren't you? We know we need to be a consistent. We need to build on our international reputation and replicate that in the UK. We need all of our great work to be out there. We do great work, but we're not showcasing it as the best way we can. We need to be better at that. So I think I've committed to quite a lot. Did I really sign up to all of this? Okay. But I think all of this is needed to support the work of my other colleagues in the college, and I really feel that moving forward, we're just going to be amazing.
Excellent, thanks. Thanks, Emma. We've talked a lot about the strategy, you know, it's the purpose of the session, and well, others will know far better than I some of the quotes around this, and I think it's the Drucker quote, isn't it, that says culture eats strategy for breakfast, and I believe that. And actually, a really big part of what we've been trying to do at the college over the last 12 months is build a culture, and build a culture where we can be successful as a team, where everybody's contribution to the college can be equally recognised, and actually where we know that the only way we'll succeed is by everybody playing their role. You know, we are greater than the sum of our parts when everybody gets together and is on this. So we extended the leadership team. You know, we did that, and you know, you've seen all the different leads, and everybody has picked up an accountability for that. But what we suddenly realised is that the most important team in the college isn't the leadership team at all, actually. It's the team of people that are there at the college every single day, doing all the work, keeping the wheels on the bus, absolutely sort of supporting the activity. And we've created this business support function which works right across the college now. So we're really trying to really, in many ways, minimise the hierarchy as much as we can. You know, and really get this notion that actually this is about working across the college. It's about utilising the full skills and knowledge of a small but elite staff team. In a way that we can provide support for the whole college, because there's peaks and troughs in our work, and we're not able to, you know, we are only a small team, so we really need to be flexible, and we really need to be able to roll our sleeves up and work across different sections. So it's been a big culture change. I think I take great heart that people have mentioned that to us. People on the board have mentioned it to us, that they feel it's a different place, the college. External customers, stakeholders have said it feels different dealing with the college now, and actually that was the only sort of priority that I set myself for the first 12 months was, can we positively impact how it feels to work at the college? Because if we can do that, then we can build from there. You know, so I'm convinced that we've got the right people. We've absolutely got the right people in the college that can now deliver against this strategy and help us be really successful over the next 3 years. With the right team in place, core to the college, the other most important people are you, our new members. And we want to engage with members, and we want to really drive a conversation and a dialogue with members so that it's beyond an annual meeting. A big way that we're going to do that is through our new website. And we're launching our new website right here, right now, live, which isn't worrying me one little bit. I think I've had a sneaky... I think Mr. Tim Gadu is one of our members. You've had your access.
I had an email inviting me.
Did it work?
I never quite got around.
I mean, you arrived in the middle of this session, so you can't go online for it.
So, as members, I'm going to go out there and say everybody that's a member should have had an email. Yeah,
should have.
Never work on live TV. I'm a live TV pets, and no. So we're hoping everybody will have an email. But what we're launching is our new website. And actually it's very interactive, it's very fresh, it's new for us. Again, it's optimised down to mobile, so it's a great step forward for us. But actually it's going to showcase our work, and you can see, you know, the bits at the top. Julie's driving it for us. So you can see the look and feel of it. We're building the content as we go. So what you're seeing is the front end. You're seeing the start of this, and you're seeing a look through who we are and the feel that we want to create. But actually, for you as members, we want to use this as a really interactive tool. So we are going to create, and we have created, a members area of the website. And Julie is going to demonstrate how quick and easy it is to log into the members area by using my username, by the looks of it. Oh, that's good. That's a lot of
password.
I wasn't remembering that. So, and this is it. So welcome back, Simon Parkinson. Clearly, I've been on it before. Clearly, I remember. You'll see your profile. I must edit it, although that's probably my best look anyway. That little unedited picture there.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah, there's all sorts of personal details around here.
Yeah, no, that's fine. That's fine. No, don't worry. I don't mind. It's all on my own. That's fine.
Oh,
except
he's never told us his
Twitter. Yeah. The Twitter handle was there, so anybody that wants to follow me on Twitter, then, you know, feel free. That's good. But if we go back up to the top and the dashboard, Julie, you can see that the feel for it will be that there'll be news and events, documents, there'll be forum posts, there'll be polls. It's going to be your central hub of members. It's going to be a way of keeping in touch with the work of the college, you know, and what we're really up to. And then, yeah, I'll let Julie just flip through a little bit. You can see some of the topics that will be up there. CEO, have you put up that? Have you put that on the CEO work of paper?
I think there's going to be a lot of job posts on this one.
Do you ever get the impression you're being completely set up? Okay, fair enough. Yeah. So you'll see, there'll be a range of ways you can interact with us. And then what we're really excited about as well is this notion of digital badging. So actually, as you can see, I've earned one digital badge, apparently, for being a participant in the Co-operative Education Conference 2016. So I'm guessing I'm not on my own in terms of earning that particular digital badge. So I think over time, I think we're just showing it there as a placeholder at the moment. But over time, give us a couple of weeks to get on with it, and you will see a digital badge appear that says you've participated in the conference. And actually, it's a real apart from just looking nice and making me feel good. There's a real benefit for it, because we can build up an online portfolio of badges. And actually, we are thinking about ways that maybe where it's appropriate, you know, there can be some accreditation behind that. There can be a way of evidencing the learning that you've done through the college, through being a member of the college. So we think, you know, there's a serious element as well in terms of just the fun and the engagement side of earning the badges. I don't know if we'll go down. Good. So, I think that was probably all we wanted to do, was just to tell you it's here, to let you know that you should have received an email as members, and we'd welcome your feedback. Bear with us, you know, over the next couple of weeks in terms of content, that'll get better and better, but actually, it'll only be as good as the content you guys are putting on as well. We can put on, we can post, we can host the forums, but actually, if you guys don't engage with it, it'll be really, really difficult for us to keep the energy levels up. So I'd encourage you to engage with it. I'd encourage you to, that David can see it. David's logged off. That works. That's one success. So yeah, so that's our new website, important tool for us. I'm going to pause there, because what we'd like to do is take any questions from members, supporters, anybody can ask. We'll try our best to answer it. And then I just want to finish after that. We've just created a film which sort of showcases some of our work. And then there's a little glass of something for everybody outside as we finish. And I think there's a few bits and pieces of nibbles, kind of bits for people as well. Just to say thank you for giving up your time into the evening and being at our first AGM. So happy to take any questions, and then we'll run the film, and then we'll release you for food and drink. So over to you guys, really. Food and drink always work. Yeah. Food and drink outside, you always advise them.
No? I've got a very simple question. How big is the college team? How many staff work at the college?
23 head count. And
and 20 FTE. Okay. So you can see we're a small team. But what we do as well is we have a broad range, both nationally and internationally, of associates. So if we're doing work internationally, you know, we have a team of associates we can call on. For the school work, we have a team of, you know, well-embedded team of associates as well. So we try and keep the core staff to that sort of headcount, and then bring people in. This actual is a growth strategy, so we will be adding 3 or 4 posts into the core staff team, mainly around the areas of schools and membership, and a little bit of an additional research sort of function as well.
So again, we're trying to put our money where our mouth is, and really think, right, we can, if we're going to do this properly, then we recognise that we need to resource it well as well. No? Excellent. Thank you. Like I say, maybe just got that away with it on the website, feeling I might have been set up as well. Yeah, no, you're fine. Again, I'm viewing this at the same time as you guys are viewing this. So a lot of trust and confidence has gone into the team that have made this. Yeah, it's a testament. I'm really confident that it'll be fantastic, he says. So, you know, enjoy it. Hopefully, you know, it just gives you a flavour of who we are as a college and what we want to be, probably, as well, where we're looking to go. So thank you again for your time, and we'll just run it through, yeah. Thanks, Steve.
Some people who just want to see co-operative education thrive.
Democracy is a massive part of our world here as well at Body Range. I think this place would be a very, very different place without those values.
There's 6 different badges: the self-help, self-responsibility, democracy, equality, solidarity and equity.
It brings everyone as a school together. It teaches you to be someone, a part of society. It teaches you to help people who need you.
That's a key strength of the place, really. We want to champion cooperative education nationally and internationally, and that's got, you know, having been committed to the cause is a major strength.
I think the strengths of the college line is its expertise.
It's got high energy levels.
The support that we get from the college really, really is important to us, and we do value it.
Great things happen when people cooperate.
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 Thank you. Yeah, I won't keep you any longer. Thanks again. We really value your support. We want an ongoing conversation with you. And, you know, please enjoy the food and drink. Thank you very much.